This month marks the 10th anniversary of India's first homegrown SUV, the Mahindra & Mahindra Bolero. We're going to catch up with Chief Executive Automotive Division, Mr. Rajesh Jejurikar, and talk to him all about the Bolero and its history. The Bolero has been a big success, and I think a lot of people didn't expect it. A lot of us didn't think the Bolero would sell in such large numbers. Even internally, I think it's been quite a surprise. So what do you think really is the key success of the Bolero? Do you think it's pricing, the low cost of maintenance, or what do you think has made the Bolero such a hit?
When we launched Bolero, the investment on the refresh, which is converting the Armada Grand to Bolero along with all the AC, redoing IFS, which is 20 crores. So, of course, the organization was hopeful, but did we think that this product will be a force to reckon with over 10 years and be the largest selling SUV in the Indian market for the last 4 years in a row?
I don't think
any of us, to be honest, had expectations of that kind, that this product would be so strong over not just the next few years but over 10 years, and hence defining or redefining or challenging what are normally product life cycles in the auto industry.
Right.
And now I think the expectations continue to be high. A lot of the DNA is about its styling, and this very sporty, muscular look that the Bolero has. That's really what's made it an aspiration brand amongst the rural semi-urban areas. So the most powerful people, the most influential people in the rural areas are the ones who own a Bolero. Of course, the fact that it's reliable, trouble-free, and so on has helped its cause, but the driving force has really been that it is the status symbol hence.
Has that really taught you a lot about the needs of the Indian consumer, and has that filter through to your other products? What you've learned from the Bolero, have you taken that advantage into your other product?
Well, it definitely helped us understand segmentation much, much better. First year of launch of Scorpio, Bolero got cannibalized a lot. And that's when we started moving it down very consciously and then conceptualized this as a vehicle for rural areas. And we, of course, had the benefit of heritage of the Mahindra brand, which Bolero was able to leverage fully in those markets. But yes, our understanding of metro brands because of the Scorpio and Xylo experience and how that differs from needs of rural customers. The basic, primal need of status or recognition does not really change between urban and rural areas.
What is the future outlook for the Bolero, and what are the plans for this vehicle in the next coming years?
Clearly, we want to continue this domination that we have. Bolero has a very good price point. It's priced between, in the 5 to 6 lakh range, which not many vehicles of this kind are able to have that kind of a pricing. So, one is keep the domination going. With changes in style which are incremental to begin with, and keep the value proposition still intact, and build advertising and communication to reinforce the imagery.
So price, you feel, has been a very, very basic and central part of the success of the Bolero.
That's correct.
Now with the SsangYong tie-up, do you think any of those technologies will filter into this level of a product in your company?
It's too early to answer it with that level of granularity, but at an overall level, the idea of doing an acquisition of the kind of SsangYong is to be able to do a larger amount of product development synergized and leveraging platforms for each other. So we would definitely want to see an effect coming in our complete portfolio by leveraging things together. We see huge synergy opportunities, and whether it will be able to come down specifically to a Bolero level without really affecting the strategy I just spoke to you about, which is maintaining an affordable price point, is something that we need to see, because we don't want to bring in technologies which upset the price point.
The Ssangyong tie-up also means that you have access to now a larger distribution network. I think that was one of the main reasons of the acquisition. Will that also be used for the Bolero? Do you think the Bolero will now see new markets?
We do export Bolero in various forms. A lot of it goes as Bolero double cab pickups to most of our export markets. So Bolero does constitute a reasonable chunk of our exports, and people actually like the Bolero look a lot because it has that retro look in international markets. So we do sell the Bolero.
Yeah, but now, like I'm saying, with the Ssangyong tie-up, there's also going to be a lot of more scope of distribution.
Yeah.
Because that allows you a larger playing field, that allows you, you know, a wider reach to countries. Will you see that also filter to like this level, like a Bolero, or is it only where you're looking at a global SUV or the Scorpio for that kind of a tie-up?
In a market like Russia, there's definitely opportunity for a product like Bolero. And we don't have a presence in Russia. And there is a significant market available in a country of that kind which needs products at lower price point. But it's like I said, too premature because we haven't got into this level of detail yet. By the time the transaction is over, it's going to be November, December. But right now it's just too early to be able to say which countries and whether it will be only the high-end products available. But one of the reasons for the acquisition is access to channel of about 1300 dealers, and we will see what's the best way to leverage it in a way that it doesn't dilute the Ssangyong brand too.